In relation to those standard form contracts for the provision of private security at the hotels, there's a standard requirement in all the contracts, and they commenced from, as you know, the night you stood everything up on the 29th of March. The decision obviously was taken on the Friday, or the National Cabinet decision was taken. You announced it in your press conference at 3 o'clock. But in the standard form contracts, there is a requirement that everyone who is working in private security in these COVID hotels must have already completed the Australian federal government's COVID-19 online control course. And even before National Cabinet broke, as I said, just after 1 o'clock, one of the companies that eventually got a contract worth $30 million called Unified Security was given a heads up because it demanded its staff on Friday the 27th of March at 12:36 that they all had to comply, do the federal government course, and that they must do it by 2:30 p.m, at which time we know was when the Prime Minister was announcing that there would be hotel quarantine. Now, the mere fact that this company who got a $30 million contract is saying at 12:36 on the Friday to its employees, before National Cabinet had even broken up, that this course must be done, that that is a requirement that was in the term of all of your state government contracts, and that the only people privy to the decision of National Cabinet, which had yet to broken up, was Mr. Eccles, who left the room and spoke to your Chief of Staff and spoke to Simon Femister. I'm asking you again, surely your Chief of Staff, who has not given evidence and has not given a statement to the inquiry, you say you set the inquiry up for transparency to get to the bottom of this.
Yeah.
This would seem at odds with transparency. Should your Chief of Staff provide evidence to the inquiry?
Who the inquiry seeks evidence from and the nature of any requests they make is entirely a matter for them. Entirely a matter for them. And I understand that whether it be Unified Security or other security providers have made submissions, they've cross-examined witnesses, they have asked many, many questions and put their view, as they see things.
Now, Mr. David Millwood didn't give testimony, Premier.
I didn't name that individual. I've named any individual. But I was cross-examined by their barrister, so I don't think it's a point of contention that they are part of the inquiry. I really don't think that.
No, I'm not saying
you could argue
I'm
that.
Reading from his exhibit, but what I'm saying was you were not questioned over this discrepancy, because I don't think people picked up that Mr. Eccles left at 12 o'clock.
Indeed, what I was questioned on is a matter for the board and council assisting and any other parties that were part of that process. The inquiry has got a job to do. Who they call, what they look at, is entirely a matter for them. And I think it is perhaps unfair to somehow run a commentary on anyone who's not appeared at this inquiry as somehow having done the wrong thing. The inquiry determines who turns up and what they're asked, and then draws conclusions from that. And let me be very clear with you and everyone, I have no involvement whatsoever in who gets called. None at all. Nor do I have any involvement in what they're asked. Nor do I have any involvement, or anyone in the government, have any involvement in the submissions that were led by council assisting.
But
a lengthy process and a very, very important
Premier,
one.
You set the inquiry up. You determined terms of reference.
I'm pleased to.
You determined that it was established as a board of inquiry as opposed to a royal commission with far greater powers than it has. Before the National Cabinet broke up at 1 o'clock, your now former departmental head left the room and communicated the decision in depth to your Chief of Staff, so says his evidence, and spoke to Simon Femister, so says his evidence. Simon Femister then went off and started to look at a whole range of detailed arrangements in relation to private security at quarantine hotels. That is no creeping assumption to me or to anyone else who can put together a timeline. And we now know that when the meeting broke up at 1:11, very quickly there was a message from Graham Ashton asking, are VicPol involved in this? And we now know a call that's led to the resignation of your departmental chief at 1:17 after a 1:16 incoming text to Eccles. Yes. Mr. Eccles calls back Mr. Ashton and says it's all okay because he went around, as you know, in subsequent texts to the AFP.
Well, no, no, no.
Saying
that's a special deal. No, no. Let's be very clear. I don't know what was said on that call. We don't know what was said on that call. You can offer a theory, you can offer a construction
of
events.
I'm offering a
with the greatest of respect, it is not for me, and therefore I won't be trying to draw conclusions from that. There's a process that's been set up to make exactly those judgments. And many others.
What instructions did you give Mr. Eccles before he left the room? Because in his evidence, and you were not asked about this, in Mr. Eccles' evidence, he says, I had a conversation with the Premier in National Cabinet before I left the room at 12 o'clock.
He's sitting beside me in the National Cabinet.
Correct. And he said he had a conversation with you prior to leaving at 12 noon when he spoke to your Chief of Staff. And we don't know what that substance was about. And we know that he spoke to Mr. Femister because Mr. Eccles and Mr. Femister have given evidence. And we now know from all the material led to the inquiry that there was work done immediately on private security, and you yourself announced it at 3:15 that same day.
What did you say to Mr. Eccles as you left the room? No such announcement was made at 3:15 that day.
Yes, there was. No. In your transcript, you mentioned private security.
Yes, and...
And your press release, you mentioned private security.
And you have, I'm sorry to say, not mentioned the very next sentence in that press conference. The transcript, the video of which is very clear, where I indicated that these matters had not been settled and I would not be able to make announcements as to the structure of the program until they had been settled. That is a rather important omission in your construction of events.
If I can conclude, it was settled at the 4 o'clock meeting that went on.
If it were or weren't, is a matter for the board to determine, not for me. I'm not advancing theories on those matters. I was asked about it and I've answered absolutely accurately. But I suppose you can't quite have it both ways, that I said something at 3:15 but it didn't happen till 4. Like, what I'm saying to you is that if you read on to literally the very next breath in the press conference that I gave, I made it abundantly clear that I could not make announcements about these very matters because they had not been settled. What's more, if I can say, these matters are not settled by me nor my Chief of Staff. These are operational matters and they are not only as a function of custom and practice, but in many respects, a function of statutory responsibilities. The Chief Commissioner cannot be directed on any matter by me. The Emergency Management Commissioner cannot be directed, other than in very limited circumstances and inconveniently for this construction, by me. I am not his minister. So in any event, the board will look at all of these matters, all of them, and indeed more.
The board didn't ask you what conversation you had with Mr. Eccles prior to him leaving the National Cabinet meeting.
Well, I can assure you I did not advise him or discuss with him doing things that would be of a deeply operational nature.
Did you have a conversation
with
Mr.
Eccles? No such conversation ever occurred, nor has any evidence been led to suggest that.
Premier, did you have a conversation with Mr. Eccles at any point at which you left the room at 12 noon in relation to security regarding hotels?
No.
No conversation at all?
No. No. Well, otherwise, how could I answer the question about... I was asked a very direct question. Do I know who made that decision? Under oath, I answered that question, no. So, of course, the answer to your question is similarly, no.